Good afternoon. So I am Ajandan Balachandran, a lead solution engineer from WSO2. So Sanjeeva will join with me. In this session, we are going to focus more on demo. So before the demo, we will discuss certain topics to set the stages for demo. So let's start with the agenda first. Yeah, so first let's look at the agenda. So first I will talk about fundamental of cloud native API management, where I will talk what is cloud native and how you can fit API management into cloud native application delivery model. Then I will introduce WSO2 API manager and its component. Then we will talk about a micro gateway. And then finally, I will do the demo. In the demo, I am planning to cover three scenarios. The first one is I will show how you can create API, publish, and consume it. And then I will show how you can create micro gateway to deploy in various environments like on your local machine, Docker, and Kubernetes. If time permits, then I will do a quick tour on API analytics of WSO2 API manager. So let's, so cloud native is one of the buzzwords in the industry. It is just more than running your application on cloud infrastructure. So let's try to define what is cloud native in today's context. The cloud native is an application delivery model, so which enable you to prototype, experiment, and develop your service and product quickly as possible and go to market without any delay. So basically, it will reduce go-to-market time for your applications. It consists of four aspects. It has a recommended architecture. It is a microservice architecture. And the deployment model, it should be a container deployment model. And then a release process. You should follow agile delivery or release process. And it also has a cultural aspect. So you should have a DevOps culture within your organization. So let's try to expand this a little bit more. So when you develop your service, you have to follow a microservice architecture. And the service should be packaged as a container and to be deployed on container management system like Kubernetes to make maximum out of your cloud infrastructure. To make agile delivery, you should follow automation everywhere. So in order to follow automation everywhere, you have to encourage DevOps culture within your organization. Also, you have to promote deeper collaboration between your operation team and development team to automate testing, configuration, and deployment of your entire application infrastructure. So you can see, in order to move to a cloud-native application delivery model, you should have a microservice architecture in place. So if you have some other architecture, then you have to think about how you can move from your monolithic or some other architecture to microservice architecture. So in next slide, we will look at when you convert your existing monolithic architecture into microservice architecture, how API management will translate. For that, let's do a small thought experiment. Let's say you have a monolithic architecture described as here, and we will try to convert this layered monolithic architecture into microservice architecture. The easiest way is you can start from services. You had to break down the services into smallest independent unit and convert into microservice. It should be lightweight, single purpose services. Then the data. In the micro architecture world, so each microservice should have its own database so that you can independently develop and deploy your microservices. Then the integration. So integration will have lots of logic. So you had to break each and every logic and create a corresponding microservice. Let's say you have a service orchestration logic, then you will create a separate microservice to do that service orchestration part. Then what about API? So according to our experience with the customers' deployment, we feel there are three possible deployment: centralized deployment, and sidecar, and private jet mode deployment. In the centralized deployment model, you will have a single pod with multiple gateway instances to handle all the traffic. So this type of deployment architecture is suitable for exposing your internal microservices to outside through the internet. So for that particular use case, this type of deployment is suitable. The second one is a private jet mode, where you will have one pod per gateway and another one for your microservice. Between your microservices and gateway, you will have one-to-one relationship. And if you have a different scaling mechanism or scaling requirement for your services and the gateway, then you can go for this approach. For example, let's say your gateway can handle more traffic, and if your services is not enough to handle that kind of traffic, then you can't have one-to-one map, because if gateway allow more traffic, then your service will crash. But if you have a different kind of different scale of scaling requirement, then you can go for this with this kind of approach, so that it will scale according to service capacity as well as gateway capacity. The final architecture is sidecar approach, where you will put your services and the site micro gateway together into single deployable unit. It will be reside in the single pod, so that when you scale the pod, both service and the gateway will scale together. So in this case, whenever gateway send the traffic, so it will use local transport. So it won't go outside. So it will reduce the time. So for internal communication, so this is the suitable mechanism. Let's say you want to allow your services communicate with each other, then this kind of approach is suitable. So these are not separate three approach. You can put both two approach together to achieve both internal API management requirement as well as external API management requirement. So in order to deploy the gateway in this kind of architecture, the gateway should have certain properties. So you can't deploy a monolithic gateway into this kind of architecture. So let's see what are the characteristics needed by the gateway in order to deploy into this kind of infrastructure or this kind of deployment architecture. So it should container friendly. The gateway should be lightweight. It should start within second, and it should stateless, so that it can be deployed as a container in the container management system. In order to make agile delivery, it should DevOps friendly. So gateway should be highly configurable and scalable, so that you can automate every aspect of the gateway, from the testing to deployment. So the next session, I will introduce WSO2 API Manager, and we will talk about how it can be used to build a cloud-native API management. So WSO2 API Manager is one of the open source complete API management solution out there. It is open source, mean the entire product is open source. We don't have commercial features, open source features. When you download the product, you will get entire feature with the product. And it also can deployable on three kinds of deployment. So first one is on-premise deployment, where you can deploy WSO2 API Manager on your own infrastructure. The second one is SaaS solution. This is hosted by WSO2 and managed by WSO2. The third one is a hybrid approach, where you can host certain part of the solution on the cloud, public cloud like AWS or even WS to SaaS solution, and keep some of the component on-premise next to your services. Especially, you can host the gateway next to your services so that you can reduce the round-trip time for your network communication. So next, we will talk about components of WCT API Manager. This is for you who are new to the product. Others, bear with me. We will talk about a new component, the micro gateway, later in this presentation. So this is the component. So we have six components available as two binaries. The first binary, we call it all-in-one, which has five components: developer portal, publisher portal, gateway, traffic manager, and key manager. So when you download all-in-one, you will get all these five components. Then analytics component is available as a separate downloadable binary file. So the first component is API publisher. It is a web portal backed by APIs. This is for who are going to develop and create API. So as an API developer, you can start creating your API from scratch, or if you have existing service definition like Swagger or OpenAPI or Wistel, you can import the existing definition and start creating the API. Once you create the API, you can apply security policy, throttling policy, and mediation policy, and publish. So once the API is published, it is ready for consumption. The application developers can consume once you publish the API. After publishing the API, you can manage versioning and the life cycle. So you can create multiple versions out of your API, and you can move your API through multiple stages of life cycle. It also provides monitoring capability. It's provide multiple dashboards to monitor the API performance and as well as subscriber behavior. So you will see how your API performing, like latency introduced by API and throughput, number of total calls. So you will able to see those details through a separate dashboard. And you also can see how your API is consumed by your subscribers. And you can see how the API is used by application developer. So based on these details, you can either take a business decision as well as architectural decision about your API. So next component is developer portal. So this is also a web portal powered by REST API. And this is for API consumers. As an application developer, you can come and search and find the API. You can even explore the API by going through the documentation and SDKs. And if you want to try the API, you can try the API from the portal itself. So once you ready to use the API, you have to subscribe, and you will get an access credential to in order to consume the API. Not only these features, it also provides a way to engage with API developers. So it's provide a forum where you can ask questions, request new features, and give a feedback to the API developers. And it also provides a minimalistic marketing feature. So it's provide a rating and social media sharing feature where you can share your API detail in social medias and do a minimalistic marketing for your APIs. So next component is a gateway. This is the primary component. WSET API Manager follow a facade pattern. So it is a proxy pattern where gateway will sit in front of your services and enforce quality of services such as security and throttling and analytics. So product provide two gateway profile. One is the API gateway. This is suitable for hosting more than one API. So you can independently host multiple API and scale the gateway. Other one is we recently introduced a micro gateway. It is specially designed for microservice architecture where you will host a single API on a single gateway. So in the API gateway, if you want to do lightweight mediation, like converting XML into JSON or JSON into XML, then you can write a mediation policy and apply. So by default, product shipped with default policy for well-known mediation scenarios. If you have a customized version or customized requirement, then you can use the offline visual policy editor where you can drag and drop and create your mediation policy and apply in the gateway. In the next slide, we will look at the architecture of WSO2 API gateway. It follows a pipeline-based message processing architecture. There are distinct stages. Each stage performs a different task. The important ones are the handlers and mediators. The handlers are used to enforce quality of service. For handling security, there is one handler. For handling traffic policy, there is another handler. The second one is a mediator stage. This will be engaged if you apply a mediation policy. So it based on demand, it will be enabled. The next component is key manager. So when you send a request to the gateway, you have to have a security credential or access token embedded into your request. Then gateway will talk with key manager and validate that token. If the token is valid only, gateway will allow. So gateway specially provide a access token. It's manage access token, the application and subscribers, who subscribe to which API, those kind of detail. And the default security mechanism supported by WSO2 API manager is OAuth2. So since it's OAuth2, key manager is just a key provider, OAuth2 key provider. The default implementation, we have our own OAuth2 key provider. But if you have existing key providers, or third-party key providers, you also can integrate through an extension mechanism. So next, we will look at the architecture of a key manager. Key manager especially interact with the gateway. As I already told, when gateway receives the request, it will talk with key manager through OAuth2 introspection API to validate the token. Then developer portal. So this is where you will subscribe and create application in order to consume the API. So that time, when you create application, it will use OAuth2 dynamic client registration API to create the OAuth2 application in the key manager. So this is a very simple architecture of key manager component. The next component is traffic manager. Traffic manager is a standalone throttling engine, which will work with key manager, gateway to enforce traffic policy. Through the traffic policy, you can save the traffic, or even you can give multiple SLAs for APIs. And it also protects your API from denial of service attacks. By default, we have tier-based model, where there will be upper limit for access. And you can create multiple tiers with multiple upper limit. And whenever you publish with those list of tiers, as an application developer, when I subscribe, I will be presented with that list. Then based on my requirement, I can select a tier and consume the API within that tier. So this even you can tie this with the monetization policy or pricing tier. So based on that pricing, you can have multiple tiers, which will have its own upper limits for access. And here you can see the architecture of traffic manager, so which has two components. One is complex event processor and message broker. The policy designer is available in the admin portal, where you define your policy, and when you apply that policy through publisher portal, the policy will be deployed in the complex event processor. Then when you access the API, gateway will send access event. So then complex event processor will apply that logic against incoming events. And if it going to take any decision to block access, it will send those events through the message broker. Then gateway will receive that event, and it will quickly deny access. So here you can see there will be a delay. So the blocking is not synchronous because it is going through a PubSub method through the message broker, and it is not synchronous. So traffic throttling or traffic shaping is not synchronous. So let's say you have a limit like 1,000 access per minute. Sometime it might exceed that one. Maybe you will be blocked after 1,005. So that is because the communication is happening through asynchronous channel. The next component is analytics component. So WSL API Manager provide two analytics. One is metrics based on the historic data, where you can get detail like performance, API performance. It will include like latency, throughput of the API, subscriber behavior, how your API is subscribed, and who is subscribing. Those kind of detail you can get. Then other analytics is alerting based on real-time event. There are predefined events. Whenever those events happening, you can get notified. So in order to get notified, you have to subscribe. So you will subscribe a predefined event, and whenever that happening, you will get notified. For example, if you want to get notified whenever backends responding slowly. So in that case, you will subscribe to a predefined event, which will monitor health of your backend. And whenever it timing out, whenever your backend is timing out, you will get an alert via email. This is the analytics architecture. So gateway will receive the access event or request, and it will create an event, and it will be sent to the analytics engine. Analytics engine will do two things. First, it will apply alerting logic and see whether are there any alert to be sent. If so, it will send the alert through alerting channel. The by default channel is email. And then analytics engine will store that receive event into raw database. It is another data store. It will store that raw event into that data store. Then there's a batch processor running time to time, and it will summarize that raw event into summarize database. Then publisher portal and developer portal will render the dashboards from those summarized data. So this is a very simple explanation of analytics architecture. So next, Sanjeev will talk about micro gateway.
Okay, thanks Ajantan. So I can see some of you attend our previous session as well. So in that case also we discuss about micro gateway and its features. But still we will discuss about micro gateway and its basics, because I can see some new people also join with this session. So please bear with me if we repeat stuff we discussed in the previous topic. So micro gateway is lightweight HTTP-based message processor, which allows you to access control and other quality of services that we can enforce at the gateway. So it is same as the gateway, but it will have a subset of features that we have in the gateway. Like we discussed earlier, so this gateway is a lightweight one, and also it is immutable. And it can work without having internet connection or without having connection to database. And also, like Ajantan mentioned, this micro gateway can deploy subset of APIs or set of selected APIs in micro gateway itself. And also it provide seamless integration with CI/CD pipelines and automation tools, and deployment is kind of easy. So if we discuss about micro gateway security, it does support both OAuth2 and both access token and also self-contained token-based security mechanism. So if we discuss about self-contained token mechanism, there what happened is when user invokes API, he have to send a self-contained token. So this particular token will have two parts. First one is the token body, and other one is the sign body. So when this request comes to micro gateway, micro gateway will get this token body and sign body and validate whether this particular token body is modified or not. So if it is not modified, then we will trust that token body and we will extract all the token metadata from that token itself. So in so if you are using API Manager previous versions, in that case we had OAuth2 token-based security mechanism. So in that case, what we will do is we will communicate with the key management server and pass the token and get the token metadata. So with that, we will validate the subscription and access API access control. So in this case, what we will do is we will get the self-contained token. We extract all the information available with that one and pass that to the authentication context. So with that, we don't need any connection to internet or any connection to key management server. So if you deploy micro gateway in lockdown environment, you have to use self-contained token mode, because if you use OAuth mode, there should be connection from gateway to key management server. So next mode is OAuth2 token-based security mechanism. So it is same as previous one. So in that case, you will have to connect to a key management server and pass that token and validate the token. So in this mode, we will have some connection from gateway to key management server. So if you, even if you use micro gateway, in this particular scenario, you will have access to key management server. So if you're using OAuth2 mode, you cannot run in a lockdown environment. So next, we'll discuss about micro gateway analytics. So micro gateway analytics works different way than the API analytics. So when a request comes to micro gateway, we'll extract set of metadata from the incoming message, and we will create a JSON payload, same as the gateway. And instead of publishing this usage data into analytics server, what we will do is we will write that in the file system. So we will have a set of files, and time to time we check size of file. If file size is exceed 2 MB or something like that, then we will rotate the files. Then after some time, what we will do is we will zip this file as a file stream, and we will push that to analytics server. So with this model, we don't need internet connection to analytics server all the time. But time to time, when we have the connection, we will push that collected information to analytics server. So analytics server can process this stuff offline and generate the stats. So then we'll discuss some of the advantages of micro gateway architecture. So like we discussed, this is specifically designed for the microservice architecture, and it is completely developer-centric approach that we followed here. And also it accelerates your development, because within very small time you can spawn micro gateway and test your service with your local workstation or any other device that you need. And also it optimizes, and resource consumption is very low. So due to this reason, you can run this in servers where you have very low performance. And also it reduces network latency. Because in this case, we don't. If you use the self-contained token mode, you don't have to communicate with the key management server. So it will reduce the network latency, and also it enhances security and DevOps friendly due to some of the characteristics of it. So now let's see when we should use micro gateway. So if you are running gateway in a lockdown environment, which do not have internet access, then micro gateway would be a good solution. And also, if you have a set of APIs in your deployment, but you will need to scale only few selected APIs, or at least one API. So in such cases also, micro gateway would be a good solution, because with micro gateway, you can get set of selected APIs and scale them independently. So for set of selected API, we can create a label, So while doing the demonstration, we will discuss about this in detail, and we can show how you can get this done. For example, you can think of label as a tag. So in tags, what we do is we will tag APIs with some kind of a tag, and label is something similar to that. So when we create API gateway artifact, we can mention the label. So what it does is it will get all the APIs associated with this particular label and create single runtime. So we can deploy this gateway runtime in anywhere that we need. And also, if you're having internal on-premise deployment, then in that case also, this micro gateway would be a good solution. And also, if you have some requirement to deploy gateways in a containers or microservice-based architecture, something like Kubernetes, Docker, OpenShift, or that kind of deployment, then in that case also, micro gateway is good because of its qualities. So now let's see how micro gateway deployment process works. So same way we do in our old API manager, API manager 2.2 or any other older version. We will have to create API, and we have to publish that. So once we publish that, it's available in the default API gateway, and also it's appear in the store. So when we set up micro gateway, we do offer some tool called micro gateway client toolkit, and we will get that toolkit, and we will initiate project by connecting to publisher. So at that time, it will communicate with the API publisher and get API metadata as a JSON file and create micro gateway runtime. This micro gateway runtime can be a zip file or it can be a Docker image. So in zip file case, what you have to do is you can generate zip file and you can unzip it anywhere that you need and just run that. So in Docker case, what you have to do is you have to pass some additional commands and additional attributes. So with that, it will create Docker image and it will push into your local Docker registry. So if you have remote Docker registry, then you can provide that URL, username, password, as well. So with that, we will push that Docker image to that registry. Then after that, we can either start that in VM mode, or else we can deploy that in the Docker or Kubernetes. So while doing the demonstration, we will see how you can generate micro gateway artifact, how you can run that in your local machine, and also how you can run that in Docker, and also how you can run that in the Minikube. So I think Ajantan will continue. So please feel free to ask any questions if you have. So while doing the demonstration, if you have any questions, you can ask. We can help you.
Okay. So the first scenario I'm going to demonstrate is creating API, publishing, subscribing, and consuming. For that purpose, I have an backend running here. So let me zoom it a little bit. It's too much. Okay. Yeah, so I have a backend running here. Get a look. Yeah, so I have a microservice running in my local machine. So it is just a simple service, and it's only implementing a business logic, which doesn't have any security or any other analytics. So by creating API out of this microservice, I am going to achieve security and analytics for my service. So let's start the demo from here. So here I have set up WSET API manager with analytics in my local machine. In order to set up that, so I already went here and click here and downloaded the binaries. Since it's my local machine, I have downloaded and set up everything here. But if you have any other platforms like or infrastructure like AWS or Kubernetes or even Docker or Docker combos, we have relevant artifacts here. And you can download and set up API manager in your choice of infrastructure. So when you download here, you will get only the all-in-one, which doesn't have analytics in. So analytics you have to download in a separate, as a separate binary. So here I have downloaded both, and I set up Java in my local machine. I exported a system variable which will point the Java home, my Java installation directory. After that, I have started the server, and now I am ready to use the WZ API manager. So as I already told, to create API, I have to first log in, go to the publisher portal. So let's go to the publisher portal. It is a localhost and port then slash publisher. And the publisher portal is secured. So in order to log in, you have to give a valid username password. In addition to that, you also should be in certain roles. You have to be in creator and publisher role. Then only you will be able to log in and create API. So here I have already created an user called publisher. And he is in both creator and publisher role. So I can use that user to create my API. So when you log in, you can see already created APIs here. In order to create a new API, you have to click here. So I will zoom a little bit. Yeah. So here you can see there are four options. The first one is if you have existing REST service, and if the interface or API definition available as a Swagger file or OpenAPI specification file, either from a file or from URL, you can import that and start creating API. So when you create API, what will happen is you have to provide setup metadata about your API. So in this case, what will happen is it will extract all the metadata from this Swagger file and pre-fill for you. The second option is for SOAP services. So when you have SOAP service, you will have Wistel, and you can import the Wistel and start creating your API. Here you have two options. One is you can create a pass-through SOAP API. If you want to expose your SOAP API as it is, then you will use first option. But if you want to expose your SOAP API into a REST API, you have to choose a second option, where we will auto-generate a REST API from your SOAP backend. The third option is the designing from scratch, where you will give all the metadata and create API. The fourth option is for a WebSocket-based API. The above ones are for HTTP-based normal REST or SOAP API, but the fourth one for WebSocket-based API. If your backend is exposed through a WebSocket transport, then you have to use this fourth option. So here, my one is REST API, and I have a Wistel, Swagger specification as a URL. Then I can choose the first option and select this URL option and provide my Swagger file. So here you can see it was able to extract the detailed metadata and added for me. Even it added interface definition, resource definition of my API. So let's give a short name. Maybe catalog API. Yeah, so first you have to give a name for the API. Using this, you can identify your API. In the developer portal, your API will be displayed with this name. Then the context. The context will be part of your final URL of your API. So this is how the gateway will identify the your API. So when it receives the request with this context, like API gateway host name, colon port, then slash catalog. Whenever a request comes with this resource, then it will detect that it's belong to this API, and it will process your policy and other settings. So So then the context will be part of the URL to identify your API. Then the versioning information, the version also will be part of the URL, and it will be used to identify the version that you are sending. You can put any string here. So you will have your own versioning policy. According to that policy, you can add any version number here. So if you want to add something, letter and number or something, you can put there. Then other two important field are this one, the access control. The first one is access control for publisher portal. So when you choose all, what will happen is all of the people who are in API creator and API publisher role will be able to view and edit your API. But if you want to hide your API from certain people, then you can select the second option where you can give comma separated roles. Then whenever user belong to that role only, will be able to view or edit the API. So here I am going to make it public, so every API creators and publishers will be able to edit my API. The second one is visibility in the developer portal. So when you make it public, what will happen is every developers will be able to discover your API and subscribe. But if you want to make it private and if you want to make it consumable by certain people, then what you have to do is you have to give a comma separator roles here. Then that API only will be visible for users who are in those roles. Here I am going to make it public. Then optional description, and then tags. So these tags will be useful whenever you search APIs. So when you search a term, your API will be indexed based on number of parameter. One parameter is tags. So whenever you search a relevant tags, then your API will be appear as a first result. So here I am going to give tag here, and then the API definition. So here it was able to extract the API definition from Swagger definition, but when you design your API from scratch, you have to define those resources from here. So either you can use this UI to generate your resource, or you can use this Swagger editor to give the service definition or resource definition of your API. Yeah, so then we can move to the next implementation phase. Here you have two options. One is a prototype option. So if your backend is still not ready, then you can prototype API from the gateway. From the gateway, you will be able to send mocked responses. There are two ways here. Let's say you have a prototyped service running somewhere else, then you can point that environment from here by giving the URL, or else you can use this inline editor and use JavaScript SDK to mock the response and send back to a callers. So in this case, what will happen is the gateway will send the mocked response based on the logic you are going to give here. But my case, I have backend ready so that I can give the URL information here and start creating my API. So let me copy my, it is simple, localhost and port. Yeah, so here you can see the endpoint type. There are three options. First one is if your backend is a REST microservice or REST service, then you will select the first one. If it is SOAP backend, then you will select second one. Third one is when you have more than one endpoint, which is pointing to different backend, and if you want to dynamically route the request based on some logic, then you have to choose a dynamic endpoint. And the routing logic you have to implement it as a mediation policy and apply separately. So my case is a REST endpoint, so I will keep endpoint type as a REST. And then you have load balanced and failover. If you want to load balance between multiple instances of your backend service, then you can choose this one, where you will be able to give multiple backend endpoint, and it will do routing based on round robin algorithm. And if you want to have your own algorithm, like weighted algorithm or something, then you can introduce your new algorithm by writing an extension. Then this failover configuration, so if you have primary and failover backend, if you want to failover whenever back primary fails, then you can choose this failover feature where you can give primary backend and secondary backend, and it will do the failover from the gateway. Yeah, so here I have just one instance of my backend service, so I don't need to choose any of those parameters. So next one is you are going to give the actual endpoint of your backend service. Here it's asking, it's optionally asking two endpoints. In the developer portal, when your API appears, you can give two endpoints for your application developers. The first one, they can use it as for production use cases, and they might have a testing scenario or automated testing scenario to be run against some endpoint. So then you can provide another URL for that purpose. From the gateway, if you want to separate both production and testing traffic and route to different backend, then you can do that by giving a separate URL here. So my case, I am going to give same URL here because I have just one backend running, and I am going to route both testing traffic and the production traffic to a single backend. And these options, whenever your backend is secured, then you have to give some credential in order to access it, right? So usual practice is, so usually what you will do is you will ask the client to send the additional credential with the API request. So, but if you don't want to do that, you can send those backend credentials from the gateway itself. So we are supporting three security mechanisms. If the backend is secured using mutual SSL or client certificate authentication, then you can upload the client certificate here, and it will automatically detect if the client certification authentication mechanism is enabled, and then it will send the relevant certificate from the gateway. If the backend is secured using basic auth or digest auth, then you have to select endpoint security scheme as a secured. Then it will provide two options. One for basic auth and one for digest. If it's a basic auth, you will be providing the username password here. The gateway will encrypt this username password and store it within the gateway. And whenever you send the request to gateway, gateway will extract and create appropriate header and send back to backend service. So my service is not secured, so I'm going to make it non-secured. So next section is this where you apply a mediation policy. During my presentation, I told we are giving some default well-known scenarios as a policy. These are those default policies, which is covering most of the common scenarios. So if you want to just validate your message, then you can use a JSON validator. But let's say you have a customized logic or customized requirement, then you will be using API Manager tooling, which you have to download as a separate binary. So when you download, you will get an Eclipse distribution, which is offline tool, and it is a graphical editor. So you will drag and drop and create mediation policy, and either you can connect to the publish a portal from the tooling itself and upload the policy, or you can export it as a XML file from the tool and upload from here. So you can apply in both way. So in this demo, the backend has a valid JSON body. So I don't need to do any modification to my messages. So I'm not going to choose this. Then this CORS headers. So if you are designing your API to be consumed by mobile application, these CORS headers are necessary. Otherwise, you will face some security limitation from the mobile application. If your backend is not able to send those headers, you can send from the gateway itself. So in order to do that, you can click, and we have included the default headers here. But if you have your customized header, you can add it here. So then from the gateway, whenever the request or response reaches the client, it will have appropriate CORS headers. So I'm not going to enable this one. Yeah, so now we will move to the next phase, where we will apply security policy and throttling policy. So this section, which enable make an API as a default version. Let's say you have multiple API version of single API, and whenever you make a certain version as a default version, what will happen is whenever requests come without the versioning information in the URL, so it's a gateway need to decide where to send. If you make one version as a default version, what will happen is those kind of requests will be routed to that particular version. Otherwise, it will send 404. It will say, I couldn't find your API. So for that purpose, you can use this default versioning feature. And you also selectively enable transports. Certain organization only allows HTTPS transport. They don't. They can't basically use HTTP, non-secured transport. So in that case, you can just unselect HTTP. Then nobody will be able to access your API through HTTP protocol. And this one is from the gateway. If you want to cache the response, you can do it. It is self-expiring cache. So you have to give a timeout. After this timeout, the cache will auto-expire. And this one is, so whenever you send a request to the gateway, you have to provide access credential. Usually, you will use authorization header to provide that access token. Sometime, your backend might be already using that header. So sometime you might not able to use that authorization name as a header. In that case, you have to use a customized name. So if you want to change that default name to something else, then you can give that name. Then in that case, what will happen is whenever your consumers are accessing the API, they have to give the API gateway specific credential or access token in that particular header name compared to usual authorization header. Then next section is throttling section. So this is where you apply advanced throttling as well as the default throttling policies. So you can apply in three level. The first one is from the backend level. So if you know the physical capacity of your backend, you can give that. So you can give the maximum TPS here. So whenever gateway receive more than that TPS, it will stop sending requests anymore to your backend. So using this mechanism, you will be able to protect your backend from overwhelming requests. So here I am going to make it unlimited, so that particular feature won't be enabled here. This one is subscription-based throttling. So this is where you will give multiple SLAs for your APIs. So here we have default tiers, but these are configurable. This name as well as this maximum limit, you can configure it, or you can even add new tiers. And here you will select multiple tiers and publish the API. And whenever consumer consume the API, they will be presented with all those options. And they can select one option and subscribe. And they will be able to only access within that limit after they subscribing using one of the tier. This is advanced throttling. Let's say you have advanced scenarios. Like, for example, if you want to limit access your API from certain part of the world or certain range of IP, then it is a advanced use case or non-default use case. In that case, you will write a mediation policy. So we have a separate portal from you will be able to develop or create advanced policy. And whenever you design that policy, so that policy will be available to be applied to enter API or to the API resources. So whenever you have that advanced policy created in the admin portal, those policy will appear in this list. So here you can apply that advanced policy either to a resource level or to enter API level. The next section is gateway. So you can have multiple gateway environment, and you can selectively apply or selectively deploy this API to certain gateway. So for example, sometime you will have use cases like internal consumption and external consumption. And if you want to physically separate those two API access, then you can have one gateway for internal purpose and other one for the external users. And you can select leap up list API from there. So in that case, you will get two options here. And you can select and deploy your API into one of those or both environment. So this is optional business information. And so API properties, so if you want to embed a key value pair here, and based on that key value pair, what you can do is you can do certain automation. So let's say from outside, from your CI/CD pipeline, if you want to do some customization or automated modification, then you can embed a key value pair here, and you can receive that key value pair in the automation pipeline and do additional logic there based on that value. And this is where you apply security policy. So by default, everything will be secured. So we close the door for anonymous access. And if you want to make it public or anonymous access, you can make it none. Then everybody will be able to access your API. And another feature is if you want to have role-based access control for your API resource, then you have to use this scopes mechanism. So you will create a scope and tie that scope with a role and create a scope there. After creating that, you can apply that scope to any of these resources. So when you apply the scope, what will happen is even though user has a valid access token, in order to access that particular resource, he need to be in that role we mentioned in this field. Otherwise, he won't be able to access even though he has valid access token. So now we are done with applying policies. So we can publish the API. So whenever I publish the API, what will happen is it will deploy the API into the gateway, and it will appear in the store. So if you go there, you can see all the metadata entered here, the backend, the version, everything. And if you want to create new version, you will create from here. So you will give versioning here. And if you want to make it a default version, so you know what is default version. And you can click here and make it a new version. So other one is a lifecycle management. So this is where you will manage your API lifecycle after publishing the API. So let's say you are going to introduce a new version of API, and if you want to retire your existing version, then what you will do is you will click deprecate. So whenever you click deprecate, what will happen is your API will move from published state to deprecated state. In this state, what will happen is, so nobody will be able to see your API from developer portal. So whenever API move to deprecated state, it will disappear from developer portal, but existing subscribers will be able to use it. So after a while, you will retire your API. In that case, what will happen is nobody will be able to access your API, but we will keep some metadata for historical analytics purpose. So you have to make sure nobody is using your API. After that, you can move your API from a deprecated state to retired state. So now we have just published the API. So now we will go to the developer portal and consume the API. So let me log into the developer portal. So all the public APIs are visible here. So you can see the API definition. If there's any documentation, you will be able to see all the SDKs. Even though SDKs are visible, but you won't be able to download unless you log into the portal. So in order to subscribe and consume this API, I need to log in as a developer. So there are two options. If you have already existing username password, or if you are already a developer or subscriber, so you can log in using your username password. Otherwise, there's a self-sign-up option where you can provide your detail and sign up and become a subscriber. So here I have one user, so I'm going to use that username password to log in. So in order to consume this API, first step is I need to create an application which will represent my application that I am going to integrate this API. So first, let's create an API. So I am going to create application. So I am going to give a name for that. And here also, you can give a throttling limit. So this will be applied across all the APIs. So I am going to subscribe to lowest possible tier so that I can show throttling from the browser itself. And there are two token types supported, JWT and OAuth. So I am going to use OAuth for this demo. So I just created. So after that, I have to use this application to subscribe to my API. So here I have to select my eStore app. And this is where I select my tier. So I'm going to select bronze and subscribe. So after subscribe, I will be able to generate or get the access token. So in order to invoke the API, first I need to get the access token. So I'm going to get that access token. So here it's generated OAuth consumer key and consumer secret. Using those two parameters, I will be able to dynamically create access token, which is valid for a certain amount of time. So here, now I have even the access token, so I can use this to test the API. So let me quickly go to the API console, from where I am going to test the API. So I am going to do a simple get operation. by giving the ID. Yeah, so it's giving the response. So while I creating the application, I have choose 10 requests per minute as a tier. If I access more than that, I should be blocked. So let me invoke this API more than 10 times within a minute and see whether it's still responding. So yeah, so now I have to wait one more minute to access again. So this is how throttling works. So here I have been blocked since I exceeded my throttling limit. So now we have shown how you can create API from your existing backend and publish and subscribe and consume. So that is the first scenario. And second scenario, so I am going to demo how you can generate micro gateway. So during the presentation, we have covered that one. So in order to generate a micro gateway, so you should have already published that API. So I have already published an API here, order API. So here you can see I have published three API, same API with a different version. I am going to deploy a corresponding micro gateway in each environment. So this version will be deployed on a Docker, this one will deploy it on Kubernetes, and this one will be deployed on local environment. Yeah, so after deploying, I will be demoing how you can access. So in order to access, you should have access token, right? So first, let me try to create an app and try to subscribe to all those APIs so that I can right away invoke the API after deploying the gateway. So let's create an app, micro gateway app. And I'm going to make it unlimited so that I can test multiple times. And this time, I'm going to demo using OAuth token type. So in the micro gateway, if the security type is JWT, it doesn't need to communicate to the outside. So it can validate the JWT token itself without additional external communication. So that is a recommended security mechanism for micro API gateway deployment. So I am going to choose that one. And then I'm going to listing page and subscribe to all the APIs. The first one is this one, MGF, and subscribe to this one. This one is Docker one. Other one is the local one. So local one, subscribe. Yep. Other one is Kubernetes. Okay. Order Kubernetes. Yes. Okay. MGF. So now I can generate JWT. So previously it was generating OAuth2 access token. This time, since I selected app with JWT security type, it will generate a JWT. So I can send this in the request header and send that request to gateway. So the next step, so let's generate or build the micro gateway. First, I am going to build a gateway and deploy in my local machine. So for that purpose, we provide a toolkit. So here we have documented. So from here, you will download and get a zip file, which will include a toolkit. So I have already downloaded that and unzipped here. So I went to bin folder, and here you can see two script, one for Linux type operating system and other one for micro gateway. So using this script, you will first create a setup project. So if you go there, first you will do a setup and then build, which will give a deployable artifact. And then you can deploy to your chosen infrastructure. So let me first build the project. So micro gateway, I am going to do setup. And I have to give a project name. So the services orders, and then I am going to use order MG micro gateway. And it can be local, so I will append local. And then you have to give API name. So if you go to the publisher portal, you can see a name of the API. So it can be local one. Yeah, it is just order. And the version is local. So it will first ask username, password, because it will talk with a publisher APIs and get the metadata. So publisher APIs are secured, so you have to give a username, password in order to access it. That's why it's asking username, password. So my publisher is okay. And the password. Then the endpoint. Here I can use the default one since I am hosted API management in my local machine. But if your API manager is having a different URL, then you can give it here. The trusto. So if you have your own certificate and import it into a different trusto than the default one, then you have to give that trusto here. Since I am using the default one, I will go with the default configuration. This is password for that particular trusto. I will use the default one. So here it will generate a project which is not deployable. So in order to deploy that project, I need to build it. Yeah, so if you look at the content of the project file, so it has a couple of source code files. It don't have any, it doesn't have any binary file that can be deployed. So in order to get the deployable file, so I need to build the project. So let me use same script. And here I am going to build, and I need to give the project name. So here, what will happen is it will build this project and get a binary file. The binary file will be available in the target folder. So if you go to the project directory, you can see a target folder. It is target here. And here you can see a zip file here. So here I have to unzip it and run it. So it's unzipped. Then I can go to the bin folder where it has a startup script. So here I am going to quickly run it. So now it's starting that lightweight gateway in my local machine. Here you can see it started within a second. So now I'm going to access this API using a curl command. So let me make sure that it's visible. Yeah, I'm going to use the curl, and I'm going to ignore the security warning, and then TTP. So it's a local host. I'm running locally, and I am going to access HTTP port, so I can use 9090. And the resource is order, and then version local. And I am going to do a get operation on all the orders provided by a particular user. So if you go there in the store, and if you go to the API or the API and API console, I am going to do this operation. So API context version then username. So let me give existing username, and then I need to provide the security credential. So I have to set the authorization header. Authorization. And token is bearer token. Bearer. And then I can get that JWT from store. There is store. And there is application, micro gateway app. And I have to regenerate. It will generate the same token again. So I copy it there. Paste it here. So now I was able to invoke this one and then get the response. So let me shut down and make sure I invoke this particular gateway. So let me shut down the gateway. Now it should give connection refused. Yeah, so it was reaching that particular gateway. So now we deployed the gateway in local setup. Now I am going to deploy the same gateway into Docker container. That is, I am going to deploy in my local machine. So then I also should have a corresponding backend in the Docker environment. I didn't deploy separate backend. Instead of, I am going to route the gateway backend back to my host machine. So in order to do that, there's a trick. If you go to the API and the endpoint detail, if you specify this as a host name, then a Docker container will route your request back to your machine. So this case, it will reach my the backend I have already deployed, instead of it reaching out backend deployed in the same Docker installation. It will reach the backend that I have deployed in my local machine. So which is simple. Otherwise, I have to deploy gateway and the backend. So in order to make time short, I'm doing this trick. So now I can just generate Docker distribution. So in order to do that, so you have to give additional deployment parameters, which will include like Docker registry that you want to upload. So that particular configuration will look like, you can give a name for your Docker image, the registry, and if you want to copy any files from your machine to the Docker image, then you have to, you can give this information. The micro gateway will have a configuration file, so that should be copied to your image. So that is mandatory, so this configuration is mandatory. Otherwise, it will use the default configuration and it will have a different setting so that sometime it won't work. So in order to generate same response as the local one, you have to copy the same file, same configuration file. So let me make sure. So this one is missing there. Resource conf and the file name. Yeah, so from the toolkit distribution, I am getting that configuration file and copying to gateway distribution. So now I am good. So I have name, and the registry I'm not going to upload to the external registry, I'm going to upload to the, my local registry, and I am copying the mandatory single configuration file. Yeah, so I am good. So I can give this deployment descriptor and generate the distribution. So I have to use same command, setup and I will use a separate project name. So API is same. The version is this time it is Docker. And then I have to pass the deployment config, and I have to point that file deployment. So I am running from wrong location. Let me check the location. Yeah. So I have moved back to the bin folder. So now I am in the correct location. Micro gateway, I have to set up. I have to give a project name. This time it's a Docker. The API name, order, and version is Docker. And then I have to give deployment config. Yeah, deployment config. Yeah, then I have to point that file I have just shown. So now it will deployment config. Yeah, 2 days. Okay, thank you. So here, it is asking for the password. From the previous command, it was able to save username and other detail. It is just asking the password again because it didn't store that password whenever I entered previously. So I need to give password again. Yeah, so now it has created the project file. So now I am going to build that project. So it will, whenever I build, it will generate the Docker image. So build and Docker. This is the project. Build and then project name. So here it will generate the Docker file and then build the image. And now it will upload to my local registry. So if I check my local registry, Docker images, I should see, yeah, and I just uploaded 30 seconds ago. So now I can use Docker command to run that gateway. So I am getting out of time, so let me quickly do it. Okay. So when I run this command, I want to expose the same port so that I can use the same curl command to run it again, test the API again. So I'm going to use port mapping, and I am going to bind to my localhost 9090, and I'm going to expose same port. Okay, now I am good. So if you check Docker P, so now it's running, so I can just invoke. I can use the same credential because I have subscribed to all the API. I have to only change the version number. So let me change that localhost because I have bind the Docker port to localhost, same port, same context. Only different is version. CK Docker. Okay, so now, yeah, so it was able to get the response from the gateway. So now let me quickly show how you can generate a deployable artifact for Kubernetes deployment. There you have to pass additional parameters in addition to the Docker detail, because even Kubernetes need an image to be deployed. So in order to pass the image, so either you can upload your image to the public Docker image repository or cloud provider registry. So if you take Google Cloud, they have their own container registry. So you can give that as a registry and upload while building this project. So then, so I am going to upload the images within the Kubernetes itself. So here I am running a local Kubernetes version called Minikube. So Minikube is running in its own VM within my local machine. So I am going to upload this image, Docker image, Docker running inside that VM, so that I have to give this URL. This is a VM IP, and this is the Docker port. And then I have to give the certificate, Docker certificate, so that I will be able to upload the image from my local machine to Docker instance that is running inside Minikube VM. So then I can provide this file and build the project this time for Kubernetes. So let me. So this time it is Kubernetes, and version should be Kubernetes, yeah. And I also have to use a different project name, because I have already used this name. Yeah, so again it's asking the only the passwords. So I gave wrong password. Let me try it again. So I have to remove already generated file. Okay, give me this time correct password. Yeah, so now the project is created successfully. Now my Docker context is pointing to my local Docker installation. But in order to upload the image from here to the Minikube VM, so I need to switch the Docker context. So there's a simple way you can do that. It is Minikube Docker environment. And if you run this command, your local Docker client will talk with the Docker hosted in the Minikube VM. So now if you do Docker PS, then you will see a bunch of containers already running because of Minikube. So now I can build the project. While building the project, it will create Docker image and upload to the Docker registry within the Minikube VM. So let me build this project. Build, and I need to give the correct project name. Yeah, so it's first building the Docker image, then generating the Kubernetes artifacts. So it is generating a service deployment descriptor and a service descriptor. Then I can apply those two files, service descriptor and deployment descriptor, in order to deploy this gateway into Kubernetes. So so let me quickly run that command. It is apply from file Kubernetes. It's inside target folder and Kubernetes. So here I have just applied that files, so it might created those services in the Minikube. So let me run the command and see whether it's running. I'm going to get it and the services. Yeah, so the gateway is running. And you also can see, maybe. Yeah, so you also can see I deployed the same backend service within the Kubernetes as a order service. Then in the API definition, I have given a different backend URL. So if you go there, select the Kubernetes one and see the edit and backend URL. So I have just given this one. Then it will use Kubernetes DNS-based service discovery mechanism to figure out the way to talk with a service. So now, and the gateway also running here. So now I can invoke and see whether it's responding. So here I have to only change IP because I have to point to Minikube base IP. So let me get the Minikube base IP. And the port, so this time, since it's using node port as a service type, so I need to use this auto-generated port. This is the port, the service available for outside. So I am going to use HTTP port, and this is the port. So let me give that port. And I have to change this to K Kubernetes. So that's it. So I can use the same authorization token, JWT, because I have already subscribed to this version. So now I am good to go. So here you can see it's responding. So now I have deployed same gateway into Kubernetes. So that's the end of demo. Do you have any questions so far? Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, that signature will be generated from a private certificate within the API API management core component. And whenever you generate gateway, if you remember, it was asking a key store and key store password. So that will have public certificate of that same certificate. So if you provide wrong certificate, then key validation will fail. So, any questions?
Hi. Yeah. Thank you. I'm sorry to cut you off there. Another question I had was about the microservice gateway generation still requires the full API gateway to be installed and configured. Is that correct, based on what you did?
It is only required for deploying micro gateway. For right. Normal gateway, you don't need.
Right, but I'm saying that in order to deploy micro gateway, you still have to have the full-fledged API manager deployed for publishing and subscribing purposes, right?
Yes, yes. Only the gateway is available as a micro gateway. Yeah.
Okay, gotcha. And as you were making changes to the API itself, like changing metadata, load balancing, and all that stuff, then you would have to regenerate the gateway and go through your deployment process.
Since
again,
micro gateway is immutable, if you change anything in the API, API metadata or anything, then you need to regenerate.
I got you. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Hi, there is in the version 2.2, we have a way to get a micro gateway as well. So can you point out the differences between 2.2 and 2.5 versions?
So, could you repeat? I couldn't get the question.
What are the differences between 2.2 and 2.5 versions of the micro gateway?
Yeah, so this 2.5 version of a micro gateway It's totally different. So it's written specially for microservice architecture. But previous micro gateway is based on the API gateway engine. But we just optimized for container runtime. Sanjivya, do you want to add?
Hello. Okay. So if you consider previous micro gateway that we offered with our cloud, WSO2 cloud, it is based on the same Synapse runtime, and we have stripped some of the component, and it is kind of a lightweight, but this one is the ultra thin micro gateway that perfectly suit with the microservice architecture. So major changes, if you consider previous micro gateway, it is based on the Synapse, but this one completely on the new different technology. And if we take the size-wise, this is much more smaller than the, if you consider distribution, this one much more strong, smaller. And also if we take startup time, previous gateway, usually it takes about 40 seconds to start up micro gateway. Even if it's a micro gateway, it takes like 30, 40 seconds to start up. So if we take this one basically start within like less than 1 second. And also previous micro gateway, we do have capability to, you know, download set of APIs. But this one we can especially use for the sidecar mode and private jet mode, because this one natively support download single API and run within it. So those are the major changes. If we consider 2.51, major features are lightness and container readiness and those kind of features.
Is there a way to deploy all APIs, or do we have to provide just one? I heard you mention the previous session that we can tag the APIs and deploy certain by tags.
Yeah. So when we create APIs, we can go to admin console and we can attach a label to API. So when we create this API gateway runtime, we can pass a label instead of providing direct API name and version. So when we pass a label, what it does is it will get all the APIs tagged with that particular label and build single distribution. For example, if you have 100 APIs and in your system, and there are 5 APIs related to healthcare system, and you need to get only healthcare related APIs into single gateway runtime, in that case, what you can do is when you set up micro gateway, you can pass healthcare as a label. Then what it does is it will go through all the 100 APIs and it will identify only 5 APIs tagged with the health label, and they download that. Once you download it, gateway runtime will have only that 5 gateways related to healthcare system. So likewise, we can get set of APIs, or else we can get one API like Ajantan demonstration.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, so here you can see I have created this label to represent a single gateway, micro gateway. Then if I edit existing application, then you can tag your API with this same name. Then you can pull all the API with tag with this test and deploy in the single gateway. So you can use this same script.
Yeah. So you're asking whether we have some kind of API to generate micro gateway artifact. So as of now, it is no. Answer is no. So the main reason is we have a micro gateway toolkit. So if you want to do some kind of automation, our recommended approach is using script. So with the script, we can bundle this micro gateway script, and we have some kind of script with call to this micro gateway script. So it's through the script, we can do that. So unlike APIs, we can. Sorry. Yeah, definitely we can do. So we have so our question was whether we can automate API creation. So the answer is yes. So we have publisher APIs, and so almost all the operations that Ajantan show through the UI have separate API to do the same thing. So you can use that API, and if need, you can have some kind of a script or client that call to these APIs, and with that, you can completely automate the API creation process.
So if you have to integrate with the Terraform or something, so do you support there?
Sorry?
If I wanted to. So do you have anything like in a cloud-specific orchestration, like in a support for Terraform or support for CloudFormthose kind of scripts?
At the moment, we don't have, but we have capability to, you know, interact with that kind of solution.
Okay.